strong.
Molecular cloning. Molecular cloning is one of the most important techniques in molecular biology and biochemistry. So let's have a look at a typical workflow. First off, I don't like the word cloning because it doesn't immediately make it clear what we are doing. You're told that cloning is copying the gene. But then I think, well, polymerase chain reaction is also copying the gene. So for a while, I was quite puzzled and unclear about this idea of molecular cloning. In molecular cloning, you are taking a piece of genetic information, like maybe the instructions for making a protein, in the form of a gene, and sticking it somewhere that supports the possibility of not just copying the gene, but having it be transcribed and translated by usually bacteria. Bacteria is the go-to because it's easier to, it's readily available. So typically the system that supports this process is a circular piece of DNA that's called a plasmid vector. Vector because it shuttles things, it allows you to take things from one place to another. Once we get our protein via a gene into a plasmid, it can be transferred or introduced into bacteria to make lots of copies. And we make lots of copies because we want to be able to experiment, we want to be able to study, we want to be able to transfer it or introduce it into bacteria so that it can make these copies for us. If you're exploring just one instance, you run out pretty quickly. So you just want to make lots of copies of it. So you can just go for it and explore and answer all your questions that you have about that particular gene as it's being translated into its protein. So that's the crucial difference here. In PCR, we're just simply working with nucleic acids, just nucleotides. But in cloning, we're actually making functional proteins, essentially, by the time that we get it into a bacteria or other vectors or other systems. So we're not just restricted to bacteria when we place our gene into plasmids. So we can put it into yeast cells if you're trying to express a protein that's quite large, for instance, or mammalian cells, you know, any protein that has post-translational modifications. Bacteria can't do that for you. So you have to use other host systems to produce the protein. But ultimately, bacteria is involved because it's usually where you want to start, you know, initially making lots of copies, and then you can take it and put it into another when you're closer to your goal or your experiments. The main strategies that can be used are restriction cloning, something called restriction cloning, and PCR-based methods. Often, when we're doing cloning, we're talking about taking the complementary DNA for a protein. It's a version of DNA that is the complement of a mature messenger RNA. So let's back up a little bit. The genetic instructions for making a protein are written in the form of DNA. You know that. You've heard that all your life. Okay, so it's in the form of a gene, and that gene is then transcribed into messenger RNA. But then that messenger RNA is translated into a protein. But before the messenger RNA is translated, it gets edited. It has regulatory components such as the introns and other regions cut out. So this process of cutting out the regulatory introns is called splicing. So now you have a mature messenger RNA. You have to make a DNA copy. So you've got RNA, essentially messenger RNA, but you have to make a DNA copy for stability so you can do your experiments with it. And so you can stick it into a plasmid. At this point, that's what's crucial to us. And so this has been the strategy that's been used to study genomes. So the genome can be studied one gene at a time by taking the RNA from the cells, converting it to this complementary DNA. You use kits, you use reagents. Then using PCR primers, you amplify out the specific gene or genes that you are interested in. Once you've performed the PCR, you want to run it on an agarose gel. Because you've run it on an agarose gel, you need to clean it up. So you use reagents to clean it up so that you can then stick that piece of genetic material into this vector that we're talking about, this plasmid vector. And then you need a bacteria. You need a bacterial vector that will then make lots of copies so that that particular gene insert can be studied in a specific context. It's a long process. So to be a vector, the vector has to have a few important things. The vector must have a promoter sequence to support the transcription of that protein when it is inserted into a cell, like an E. coli. The vector should also be able to subsequently translate the protein that it transcribes so that it is functional. In bacteria, the transcription and translation are coupled. The vector must additionally have something called an origin of replication. This is a functional site in a vector that supports binding of DNA polymerases so that the polymerase can drive the copying of that gene that we want copied and multiplied. Multiplied as the bacteria replicates its genetic material. An important point here is that the bacteria replicates the plasmid independent of its own genetic material. Plasmids are called extra chromosomal for that reason. What is really handy about plasmids is that they have characteristics that can be manipulated or engineered to allow us to be able to identify plasmids that have taken up our gene insert, and that characteristic is the ability to resist antibiotics. This is referred to as a selection marker. Selection markers can be against an antibiotic such as ampicillin, gentamicin, kanamycin, you name it. But here's the thing. Just because the plasmid is resistant to the antibiotic, it gives you a clue that it's got your insert, but it doesn't indicate whether your insert has gone in the right orientation. So here, there are several techniques that can be used to check which plasmid inserted your gene correctly. One of these approaches is via colony PCR analytical digest, where you perform PCR on various colonies that you pick from a plate of bacterial colonies, the bacteria that have survived the presence of antibiotics. This preliminary check just gives you an idea that you have the right insert before you send it off for sequencing in order to confirm that you really have the sequence correctly. So now let's talk about how do we get the sequence into the plasmid. The DNA, cDNA sequence that we want to express, how do we get it into the plasmid? Be strong.